So without further ado, I'm Trey Darley from New Context. This is my co-presenter and friend, Jason Kierstead from IBM. And we're here to talk to you today about STIX patterning in STIX 2. So
without further ado.
So important front matter, always. Next slide. So we're going to try to give you a little bit of history before we talk about the state of affairs today. And this may become more relevant as we move through the next couple of slides. Jason?
One of the things that led us to the creation of what we're going to discuss throughout this slide deck was an attempt to resolve and correct what we and the technical committee felt were a lot of the mistakes that were that due to paths that we led down when we were developing STIX 1. But before we proceed here, just to get kind of a state of affairs of the knowledge of the audience, like when we say STIX, who in the audience knows what STIX is? Okay, very good.
Who in the audience has done anything with STIX? Okay. Who in the audience knows what we mean when we say STIX 1 or STIX 2? Okay. If you've messed with STIX 1 and you haven't looked at STIX 2, it's radically different.
Right.
STIX 1, well, we're going to tell you some of the differences, but just to foot stomp, when we're talking about STIX, we're talking about STIX 2.
Yeah. So to lead off the presentation, we're going to go off and talk a little bit about, you know, why some of the decisions were made that we're going to talk about through this deck. So what was wrong with STIX 1.x? We got a lot of feedback from a lot of practitioners that STIX was extremely complicated. And one of the things that was complicated around in STIX 1.x was the way that you define indicators and how to match things with STIX. There was actually too many ways to define matches of things. There were actually multiple meanings of what equals meant in STIX 1, if you believe it or not, when you actually dive into the specification. There were too many ways to define expressions. You could actually, if you were trying to create what's called a composite expression, so you're trying to match two different things, an IP and a URL, for example, you could actually do it in multiple different ways. You could do it either as an indicator at the indicator level or at the observable level and tie those together. And as a result, you know, some people would do it one way and some people would do it another way.
And some people would do it both ways.
And some people would do it both ways simultaneously, right? And depending on the way that the tool that was consuming that was written, it may or may not actually work. It may or may not do what you expect it to do as a result. One example of when you combine these things together, multiple ways to do equals, multiple ways to do ands and ors, just too many ways to do the same thing. One person actually did a count and found that there was actually 12 different ways in STIX 1 to just compare two IPs, which, you know, if anyone's involved in software development here, you can just imagine the code paths that you have to create to try to bring all this together. Some other things, lists were just odd, plain weird. You used to have to put hashes with commas in the middle of the lists. Despite all of that complexity, right? So naturally you think that complexity leads to capability, but you still couldn't do very fundamental things like temporal matching. So you couldn't define an indicator that described malware that says, okay, this file should get created on disk, and then, you know, 5 seconds later, it will reach out to this certain IP address or destination. You couldn't define that in STIX 1.x. There was no temporal matching at all. So that's kind of some background into why we went down this path of STIX patterning and some of the problems we were trying to solve. The next thing that we come to is, you know, a lot of people come to us and they say, you know, why are you trying to make your own patterning language? We already have so many. We have Snort. Snort's really good at finding things on the network. Why do I need another patterning language? Or why do we need something? I have Yara. Why can't I write all my signatures in Yara and just share them with people. So, and all of these different languages are extremely useful and necessary, I would argue, and you know, have huge communities around them, and they're not going anywhere, and we realize that. The problem is that they all have unique capability sets. So Snort, for example, it only makes sense on the network. I can't use Snort to describe malware behavior, right? So then Yara comes in. I can write Yara, but Yara only works on a file-like blob. It's used to basically find files. And you can use Yara to find files in the wire. You can use them to find files in the disk.
Or in memory.
Right, or in memory, or anywhere. It basically works on a blob of data. But you can't use Yara to actually describe network traffic. It just doesn't work. That's not what it's made to do. Neither of these allow encoding of malware behavior, right? So I can write a Yara rule that will find a piece of malware, find a piece of a file that matches these things, but Yara can't describe the thing I was talking about earlier, a certain file appearing and then a certain behavior occurring, reaching out to an IP command and control, or a piece of malware that should create a bunch of registry keys and then go and try to hide itself a certain way. We also have some things like OpenIOC. OpenIOC, you know, it's capable, but it has some limited expressivity. You can express some things in it, but you can't really express some of the really complex malware behaviors we're trying to do. It's also limited in its coverage of network-based IOCs. So this is an example, you know, it's related to what I was saying earlier. View this basic use case. So you want to find malware that matches a certain signature, and it's going to beacon out with certain traffic, and that traffic should look like Y, and then it's going to drop Z, be that a registry key or you know a dropper, or it's trying to you know exert persistence on your endpoint. That's the use case that we're trying to be able to cover, and you know we realize that the vast majority of indicators today are a lot simpler than this, but we're trying to kind of move the needle a little bit. But and we'll get into that further in the slide.
I think one more point that's worth making is before we went on, so we did this evaluation of STIX 1 and we're like, okay, these are the things that we want to fix.
Yeah.
But before we went off and created a new standard, right? I'm sure many of you have seen that famous XKCD standard about there are 18 standards. This is messed up, and you wind up with 19 standards. We did due diligence. We looked at everything that we could find. We polled the community for suggestions and evaluated options. We tried glomming some of these things together before we set about the work of creating STIX patterning language.
Right, and the, you know, the where we're going to get to in this presentation is you know, some other factors that we're trying to take into account that we're really trying to, that we think that this is going to lead to some advancements in the current state of affairs, threat intelligence. Before we move on, the final example I'll just touch on is there's a current work effort, a very nice work effort going on with a project called Sigma. And that's been brought to our attention a couple of times. You know, are you guys looking at Sigma? You know, how come STIX isn't just using Sigma? So Sigma is a, you know, it's a very, you know, powerful way that's been created that it's trying to be the snort of log files. And that's the way that it describes itself on the website. The idea is that, you know, let's create a common language that, you know, SIEMs can use to describe, you know, what you would call a basic match on a file or on a log. And I'm going to look for these fields, and these fields need to be these values. And you know, this is a way that we can share these things, being platform agnostic. You know, it's a great project, very useful. But what I would argue is it's the same. So now we have a third, right? So we've Snort for the network, Yara for the endpoint, and Sigma for the logs, right? And how do you combine these together? It's the same problem set, right?
And like. We got to know each other. Jason works on QRadar. I'm sure you've heard of that if you played around with SIEMs. I was brought into this when I was working with Splunk security practice. So like we respect the value of log files, but we don't assume that you're just going to match indicators in a SIEM. You might be doing that like on the wire. You might be doing that on the endpoint. And so we wanted to enable that.
Yeah. You don't actually always have logs where you're trying to find these indicators. Sometimes you're trying to find them live. Sometimes you're trying to find them in other ways. So we just want to bring that up, you know, make sure that it's clear that we have looked at various different things in the industry. This isn't a science project. You know, so while we were trying to develop this patterning language, here's some of the questions we asked ourselves. So while the vast majority of IOCs today are very simple atomic indicators, IPs, URLs, et cetera, should we try to think beyond those simple use cases of finding these atomic indicators? What if our tools could share things like rules and searches for analytics and correlations in a more efficient way, right? Like, should we be trying to think of this beyond even just a threat intelligence problem? Should we be looking more to the analytics world so that if I'm a Splunk user and I define this really amazing query that finds something in my environment, that I can share that with my ISAO or ISAC or even just the guy I know across the street in another SOC, and he can consume that in his SIM, which is not Splunk. Or he can run it on his endpoint, and it can still be valuable to him, even though he doesn't have the same tool chain. So this is something that, you know, a lot of us have been talking about for years. Security is a team sport. Everybody should be collaborating and sharing. Everybody knows that this is a good goal, but what are the factors that are preventing this from emerging in the industry? As the OASIS CTITC defining STIX and TAXI, do we have an opportunity to try to move the needle forward here and advance the state of affairs? And yeah, so what if SIEM, and I would argue actually, what if vendor lock-in, period, would just die in a fire? You know, in the security industry, a lot of tools, you know, the barrier to move from toolchain to toolchain is extremely high because you've invested a large amount of time, energy, and often services dollars defining massive correlation rule sets and defining matches and defining custom patterns and custom integrations and things like that on your platforms. So shouldn't we be encouraging vendors to compete on capabilities and not based on how locked in your data is into the
Oh, sorry, I forgot about that.
You know, so obviously a lot of you know, kind of lofty goals there, but you know, Steve Jobs said before, we're here to put a dent in the universe. We're trying to think big, right? Think big and not necessarily just solve the simple problems.
So we started off with some basic design principles. Where in STIX 1, there was a lot of optionality and many ways of doing things. Wherever possible, we wanted there to be one way of doing things to avoid what we had before, which was like different vendors and communities having different kind of STIX idioms, and then you have to pick up the phone and say, okay, you're doing this way, and I'm doing this way, and kind of this mapping exercise that was frustrating. We wanted to base things on a grammar, because this is a language. So it's based on antler grammar, which makes it very easy then to, depending on whatever language you use, generate a parser that's going to be pretty robust, and not using, you know, XML schema.
It also makes it a lot easier to read.
So. Yeah, also that.
Right.
So we wanted it to be in a syntax that humans could like read and create by hand, because some people like use VI or Emacs or whatever, but also something that would be like inexpensive for machines to operate on. And like I said, we based it on antler grammar that's widespread within the industry. We looked at a number of other sort of query-oriented tools for inspiration, and what we wound it up with was a SQL-like syntax that's widely understood and seemed fit to purpose. So we defined a grammar that we're going to start diving into now. But I hope everybody's still awake. Gonna try not to bore you. And also, we wanted it to be expandable because standards bodies move slowly, but threat actors don't. And so the language needs to be able to expand its powers and adapt to detect new things. So
now we're going to go through an overview of STIX patterning. And you know, this is where things will get a little bit technical about the next 5 minutes or so. So the basic structure of a STIX pattern. A STIX pattern consists of one or more observation expressions that are joined by what we call observation operators. An observation operator, that's basically and, or followed by, right? So you're trying to define patterns and then join them together with these things called observation operators. Each one of these observation expressions, it can either be a simple test, like IP equals 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, or it might be multiple different tests that you combine to create an expression. The comparisons inside the expression are separated by operators, which are things like equals, greater than, less than, in, like, etc. And the entire observation expression, you can follow with a qualifier. So you can say repeats X times or within Y seconds. So that's what enables you to do your temporal matching. It lets you define a pattern and then say this has to be followed by this other thing within this time window.
Should we maybe laser pointer this real quick? I think you have a laser pointer.
Is there?
I think so. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. So just to help you with this lovely diagram, like this bit right here, is this going to work? Come on. There we go. Can you see that? That bit and that bit? Like that might be, you see this on the same host, followed by maybe this is something that you see on like DPI or somewhere else. Does that make sense how it's kind of like grouped by where you observe it and then chaining it together? And then constrained by these qualifiers at the end.
It doesn't matter. Sorry. There's another laser pointer here.
Oh, I didn't know. Okay, sorry. Well, we don't need a laser pointer anymore.
So that's basically the language, right? You know, it's a little bit complex. And then the way that ties to cyber observables, right, in STIX, is that's the language that describes what you're trying to find. And cyber observables define the actual objects that you're trying to find it in and the combinations of those. You know, so we tried to come up with a couple of analogies. You can kind of think of it as STIX cyber observables are the nouns and the patterning grammar is the language that those nouns are used in. Another example, it's not as clean, but STIX cyber observables are kind of like database tables and patterning is like the SQL that you're using to query those tables. Now, one thing to point out, sometimes there's a little bit of confusion assuming that if I write a STIX pattern, it's matching against STIX data. And that's not the case, right? STIX cyber observables are a data model, and it's just used to describe what you're looking for. So if I write a pattern that's saying, malware file hash name equals X, I do not necessarily need a piece of STIX JSON somewhere with those attributes to find that. That pattern, because this is a grammar, it's relatively easy for vendors to add support for this grammar to their tools. And then, you know, if you have an endpoint system, it reads that, and then it starts looking for files with that hash in it. So I just wanted to make that clear. You know, so this sounds incredibly, you know, this is where we get to the point in presentation where we kind of see people's eyes glazing over, and they're like, I just want to find an IP address. Why are you throwing math at me? Do you want
to? Okay, so we weren't quite sure where to put this slide. This felt like the right place. I'm sure many of you have seen David Bianco's Pyramid of Pain. So as Jason just said, this all seems a little bit complicated. And we didn't want to make it complicated. But sometimes you need to make a thing sufficiently complex to achieve an end goal. And we tried to do that, but no more than necessary. So what we're about to show you is how to do the simple stuff that everybody does today, like hashes and domains and URLs. But the complexity that you may be scratching your head at is because our long-term goal is to enable people to move up, this to be able to share indicators and match on things that are going to cause more pain to attackers and force them to make more expensive alterations in their TTPs or their infrastructure.
Yeah.
But how do I do how do I match an IP, Jason?
Well, matching an IP is actually fairly simple.
That's a false positive.
So finding an IP address, it's actually not complicated at all. Fairly simplistic, X equals Y. If all you're doing is looking for something, it's actually very simple, and I would argue a lot simpler than it was in STIX 1, because you don't have to understand XML. You don't, if you're trying to find multiple things, you just write and this, you don't have to make esoteric lists.
I could write a two-line bash script that would like generate tens of thousands of valid STIX indicators.
Yeah, it's fairly simplistic. Finding a URL, we actually even threw a regex match into that just to show, how it's intuitive. It's very similar to if you've ever written a SQL query against a database. It should be very intuitive. And then the final example, we've got actually two registry keys in there. So that example looks a little bit longer, but most of the bytes in that are the names of the keys themselves. So it's just X or Y. It's fairly simple. Doing simple things in STIX patterning is simple, but we also wanted to enable the power. So just touching on the cyber observable model. So STIX patterning relies on the cyber observable model to define what you're going to match, as we were describing earlier. These objects right here in the slide are the currently defined cyber observables in STIX 2 that you can write indicators for. As we mentioned earlier in the presentation, not only is patterning engineered to be extensible, but STIX itself is engineered to be extensible. So by no means is this the only thing you can write patterns for. These are the things that are currently standardized. You can actually write patterns in the grammar for anything you want, including vendor custom fields and things like that. Obviously, if you write a vendor custom pattern, and share that with somebody else who doesn't have that exact same tool, they may not be able to consume it. But the goal in the CTITC is to try to use these extension mechanisms for us to learn what in the community people want so we can try to drive the standard forward, as opposed to what we did with STIX 1, which was kind of like, we want the community to tell us what is important to match instead of us trying to guess what the community needs. Do you have anything to add there, Trey?
Well, there's some stuff that's missing that we're aware of, and there's other stuff that's missing that we're not aware of. But we would love help, and we are actively reaching out to subject matter experts in domains that we're aware that there are gaps in the data model, where there are types of attacks or malware where like certain metadata would be very useful for detecting that. Engaging with these subject matter experts, trying to define a data model that, I don't know, Jason knows everything, but I don't. Something that is going to work not just for one vendor or one tool, but generally work for the 80 to 85% union of use cases for that specific domain. So if there's something that you see that's missing on here, that's calling out to you, like, come up to one of us afterward and let's have a conversation, because we're not presenting this as like a fait accompli.
Yeah. So that all sounded great. So we showed you what you can do simplistically. What is the actual power of this? What can we do in the future? What can we enable? So here's a basic pattern. This is an example of how you can do the equivalent of what you can do in Yara. Right? So below, we've got a fairly simple Yara rule. I'm looking for this certain hexadecimal string for a piece of malware. And above is the equivalent STIX. So as you can see, you have rough equivalency. If you can do it in Yara, you can probably do it in a STIX pattern. Now, the pattern might be longer, right? Depending on the structure of your Yara rule and how that ends up getting encoded as an indicator pattern, you know, it might seem harder to read. It's long. One of the things to remember, though, is we do not envision that the majority of indicator patterns will be written by humans with their hands.
Or read by humans.
Or even read by humans. Our target is machine-generated, machine-readable, right? So while it's a nice fact, nice, you know, bonus that STIX patterns are human-readable because of SQL-like grammar, at the end of the day, our goal is to increase automation, increase compatibility between cybersecurity products, and it's basically the product that you're using should be generating the indicator most of the time, not an analyst.
So we're coming up to the halfway mark, and we want to save time for questions. So we're going to try to move through some of these use cases at a little bit of a faster clip.
Yeah.
But if there is something, again, you have a question, comment, feel free to step up to the mic.
And yeah, and just to reiterate the handouts here that you can pick up at the end, there's use cases on those handouts as well. So another example, this is another Yara example that's just matching on a different type of payload. Now we have a network-based pattern, right? So, you know, earlier in the presentation, we were talking about how we wanted to be able to accomplish both file and network. So this is an example of a snort rule versus an indicator pattern and how you can encode that. Again, yes, the snort rule is more compact. It's more succinct, right? However, there's still significant advantages here because of the ability to correlate across both network and endpoint. Here's another example that's a snort pattern. This one is actually looking for a user agent. Now here we have one of the more complex use cases. This is an example of a Windows UAC bypass. If you Google UAC bypass, this is fairly common knowledge now, this analytic. It's shared all over the place. So here's how you can express the analytic as STIX patterning. I'm looking for a registry key with a certain type of value, either that or a different type of registry key with a command line value. Here's another example of a bad PowerShell pattern. Again, this is a fairly common analytic. You can look up on the web. In this case, I'm looking for certain type of command lines that are being executed. I'd probably be matching this against things coming in from Sysmon. Now, this is where you really get to show the power of STIX patterning. This pattern here cannot be expressed in any of the aforementioned languages because it's actually combining file-based attributes with network-based attributes at the same time with a temporal match. So this is a pattern. It's a you know, fairly simple indicator pattern you can write that will look for the Nicker botmanet. And again, the only way to do this with snort and say Sigma, you'd have to run them in two different tools and then stick them together and try to tie that yourself.
Ah, so. What can I do with this today, you ask? Well, the answer is quite a lot. When I got involved with the STIX community, there was not a lot of documentation, almost no sample data, and people were still really just trying to work together to figure things out. We have developed extensive documentation. We have training, which is currently being developed by the community. I believe some of that's available already on GitHub. We have on the CTITC wiki, which I think we're going to link to on the next slide, links to a whole plethora of libraries and command line tools, whether you want to just interact with STIX patterns directly, whether you want to do STIX taxi client, taxi client server, or like Munch STIX 2. So, and these are available in a host of different languages, unlike before where everything was developed by MITRE, sponsored by DHS. There are people all over the world developing these in different languages. So take a look there at that, I promise, not malicious, shortened URL. There's also a whole table of links to OSS and data available on like three or four different Taxi2 servers, scads of sample data. So if you want to play around, do a little bit of hacking, see how other people are structuring their threat intel, you know, to inform your learning process, that's, we've come light years from where things were a few years ago.
Yep. So, we're actually not done either. You know, so we've defined this language, we've defined this powerful grammar. But again, we're trying to, you know, like we were saying earlier, put a dent in the universe. What if, you know, today threat intelligence sharing has a lot of focus, and you know that's kind of the actual mandate of the CTITC, Cyber Threat Intelligence TC. It's about standardizing the sharing of cyber threat intelligence. However, you know, with STIX patterning, we're trying to take an even more broad approach as to, you know, not necessarily looking at this just from a threat intelligence perspective, but more of a sharing cybersecurity information perspective. The focus to date often when the sharing communities is around sharing threat intelligence. You know, hey, I saw this IP address. Have you seen this IP address? Hey, let's go to this vendor. They have a really good blacklist of IPs. This vendor has a good blacklist of URLs. Here's a feed I can buy that has a blacklist of malware. Or maybe you're not buying these things. You're using OSINT. You know, lots of open source intelligence feeds out there, or you're getting things from your ISAC or ISAO. The key is that to date, a lot of these things have been really focused on sharing threat intelligence. And I would argue, you know, it's getting a lot better than it used to be, even 2 years ago. You know, the willingness to share back information. However, you know, people where to date we've been focused on sharing threat intelligence, there's been a lot less focus on sharing the analytics and the way to actually find these things. So I'm sharing this IP address, but I'm not really sharing with you how I found it.
What are you doing with that in your environment? Yeah. What makes that valuable to you?
Why is this malware hash important, right? People tend to then rebuild the same analytics over and over and over again because they don't necessarily know what's been done before. And you know, the interesting thing from my perspective is a lot of people, you know, these analytics, they're even more sensitive sometimes than the intelligence themselves, right? So people want to keep them in house because they say, you know, if I share this analytic, then other people will know what tool chains I have, and if there's vulnerabilities in those tools or there's gaps in my coverage, the adversaries now have a better view into my environment and they may be able to attack me. But you know, what if we could allow you to share these analytics in a way that didn't expose what tool chain you're using, that they didn't know what capabilities you have and did not have, that it was vendor agnostic. So in order to do that, we would need a vendor neutral language for these types of analytics. And the thing we'd like to propose is that STIX patterning is powerful enough to be that standard. We believe that it could be the basis for this. We know that there's some gaps in STIX patterning. There's some gaps in the capabilities. But you know, if you go by the 80-20 rule, I would argue we're very close to the 80. As far as, you know, if you have a SIEM and you have a correlation rule written for that SIEM, I would argue the incredible majority of them could be expressed in STIX patterning without you know, having any coverage gaps. Same with search queries. If you have a search query written, a great big query that you run against your data lake, I would argue that it's extremely likely that we could take that search query and encode it as a STIX pattern. So, you know, where we're trying to get is we're trying to move the state of the industry to use these patterns and have vendors add support for them to their products.
What's this car thing? What's this? Has anybody ever heard of this thing?
Has anybody here heard of CAR except for John Wonder?
So has anybody here ever heard of the MITRE ATT&CK framework? Raise your hand. Anybody heard of MITRE ATT&CK? It's kind of hot, the hotness these days. So this is a project, and I'm going to forget some of the people involved, but it's like run by NHISAC, and there are a bunch of people from large institutions, financial institutions, government, et cetera. But they're basically taking all of the little squares in the attack matrix and like, okay, you take this one, you take this one, you take this one, and developing generalized analytics, like almost like a pseudocode type of algorithm to detect that type of behavior, wherever that falls in the copyright Lockheed Martin kill chain. And these then are, like, one of the things that's driving the innovation in STIX patterning is our use cases coming out of this group. The goal being, I believe, and John, correct me if I'm wrong, that ultimately there will be a curated set of analytics in STIX patterning that are able to detect all of these different types of malicious behavior in the MITRE ATT&CK framework.
And again, going with the 80-20 rule, right? If you can use the community to help you with the 80%, then that can really allow you to focus your precious resources on the 20%, the things that are specific to you. Excuse me. I mean, we're not trying to make the argument that, you know, you'll consume CAR and MITRE ATT&CK and you're good to go. but if you can leverage the community and work with others and figure out ways that everyone can work together, it'll help everyone take care of that 80% case so that you can focus on your industry-specific things, your things that are specific to your company and your enterprise.
Okay, so you've got the general gist of this. I think we've covered that. I hate people reading slides at me. So creating a collaborative ecosystem, whether it's in CAR or whether it's in an ISAC or in FIRST or in whatever ad hoc trust group, you know, you and me go for beers every Thursday. Let's say like there's some new ransomware outbreak tomorrow, and like you or one of your SOC analysts start to write some kind of SIEM search or something based on early data available on Twitter or blog posts or coming down the wire from friends and GPG mails. Start to write a search. You can publish that initial draft like analytic for this ransomware in your sharing community, and then like you consume that and you look at that in your environment and you say, well, you know, like more information is available now, or my analysts are better than your analysts. Yeah. Iterate on that. Publish another draft that says, you know, suggested update to the initial one, and over time converge on like, okay, here is an analytic or correlation rule that detects this type of ransomware. So why would I have 12 organizations with 12 analysts working on that on the day of the outbreak, when instead, like, you could have fractions of those, like, working together to improve the overall product and have, like, a high granularity capability to detect that, like, much more quickly?
The other thing I'd just add, since not many people raised their hands about that they had heard about ATT&CK, I'd highly recommend you go to the site, check it out. This presentation is not really about ATT&CK. ATT&CK, we could do a whole hour on by itself. But I'd highly recommend. There's so many useful use cases for ATT&CK, including, you know, in addition to the things we're talking about, is from a sharing perspective, you can use it internally to assist you with your red and blue teaming activities and things of that nature. So
we kind of went a little bit wonky on our timing. Apologies. So SIEM correlation rules are basically analytics. Our desire, having like spent a lot of time in the SIEM world, is to say, you know, these guys compete on like, we have 100 correlation rules and we have 150, and like that's really not valuable. Like enabling this type of data to move like rapidly within sharing communities is much more valuable. We want to really eliminate vendor lock-in, enable a broader ecosystem, and really if there's one takeaway here, if this resonates at all, like, you have influence over your vendor, whether it's in RFPs or casual conversations with like an SE during a POC, ask them, what are you doing with STIX patterning? If it seems at all relevant, because you can vote with your dollar. Nothing moves ahead without customer demand in the market. And I think I have to stand here for that to work. Okay, so we've said some of this before. We need your help. It's a relatively small team of people who are doing most of the work. And if one person in this room came up to me after this talk and said, you know what, this sounds cool. I don't think you guys are crazy. You know, I don't think this is all a bunch of unicorns farting rainbows here. I think there's actually some meat and potatoes. I want to help. If one person came up and said, I want to help, that would be success. So it's not just us. There are a lot of companies and institutions involved. We'd love your help. Whether that's like if you feel like you don't have a good hobby and you want to get into standards development, I can recommend that as a scintillating, thrilling hobby. Or if it's just casually like dropping a mail, we have like a CTI users list that anybody can post to with suggestions or questions. Yeah. Next actions. This is our last slide, I think, pretty much. Mm-hmm. Ask your vendors or your product managers, if you are a vendor, about the roadmap, if this seems relevant. We'd like your help, and go home and relax. So with that, any Q&A, and here are our contact details if you want to follow up afterward. Again, there are handouts down here.
Yep.
Feel free to grab those.
If anyone has questions, I think there's microphones there that are live. So.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It's not a real question. I want to say that we are pushing vendors to support STIX. They're announcing, yeah, we're going to support STIX, and then we read their release notes, and then they say, we just accept hash.
Uh-huh.
It's meaningless, and then they check, yeah, we are supporting STIX. It's
so,
a problem.
Yeah. So there's multiple aspects to that. With respect to some of the vendors, you know, if your product, for example, is only working on the endpoint and all you have is a file, maybe all you can do is a hash. Some products won't be able to do everything, and we understand that. One thing that you are touching on there is, as a consumer, how do I know what a vendor means when they say support STIX?
Does it do what it's supposed to do?
So we didn't put any of this in this presentation, but there, another very large effort that that we're doing at CTITC is interoperability testing and standardization of the tests for STIX. And you know, I'm pleased to let you know that a couple of weeks ago, we announced we're working on the ability for vendors to, we're coming up with a certification program that the vendors will be able to kind of submit their tests to us, and we will issue them the ability to call themselves something we call STIX preferred.
So there's a set of sort of personas for types of products or tools that people have said, okay, these are categories of things that would operate on this type of data, and for each of those we've said, okay, these are use cases.
Yeah.
Working with vendors and tool makers to define what are the use cases, here's sample data, and here are a series of basically unit tests that can be run to say, okay, I'm a SIEM, I'm an endpoint solution, in order to be able to call yourself STIX preferred, in order to be able to put this logo on your box, that's going to be the way that you can say, like, okay, this is, you know, oh, FDIC ensured that there's some minimal level of vetting that's happened, and that it's not just STIX. So if it doesn't say STIX preferred, and we're not starting this, it's pretty well done. Like
the legal paperwork
is like almost finalized, and we have our second interoperability plug fest coming up in a couple of weeks. So there is a there, and because we're trying to solve what is a problem.
You can expect that to be coming out in the summer. And and this would be another opportunity, right? So again, we're going to come out with this ability for vendors to say that they're preferred, but the customers will have to push that demand and write and say, you know, as part of my RFP, you need to be STIX preferred for this persona.
So I think we can take one more question and then our time is up.
Just a quickie, just to make sure, is STIX patterning part of the preferred piece or is it regular
STIX? It's part of the testing suite, yes.
Yeah, it's part of the testing suite and depending on the persona, it defines which things you have to be able to do. So we didn't really describe it in great detail, but there's a variety of personas that are part of the STIX testing. For example, you know, a threat mitigation system, which would be like a firewall device. And then there's a SIEM. And then there's like an endpoint type of a system and a system that's a TIP, a threat intelligence platform. So we've got this list of things, personas. We don't want to call them like product verticals, but they're...
So we've used up our allotted time, and I want to thank RSA for giving us this opportunity and thank all of you for coming in on Friday morning and listening to a talk about standards. Looks like nobody's sleeping. Thank you very much. We're going to move out to the hallway if you want to have some more Q&A or in-depth discussion. We'd be happy to engage in that. Again, thank you to folks in the room who helped us.
Thanks
a lot. Thank you for your time.